Today's social revolution, playing out in parallel with the pandemic, ensures that diversity can no longer be ignored and that a one-size-fits-all wealth management model has been consigned to the history books, with hyper-personalization becoming the new normal. This discussion with Nannette Hechler-Fayd'herbe, Chief Investment Officer at Credit Suisse's International Wealth Management Division, and Marisa Drew, the bank's Chief Sustainability Officer, will identify which investment themes are most appropriate for women clients. Nannette, many wealth managers that we speak to have been busy building a new women-centric wealth management model, but with varying degrees of success. What have been the major challenges of this approach, and how successful have they been in dealing with the urgent issue of trying to close the gender investment gap?
I think the financial industry so far has not been very successful at all in engaging women more with their money and their investments. In fact, research shows that the emotions women associate with financial planning often are stress and anxiety. Now, women do have distinct needs and preferences as well as characteristics that call for an investment approach that indeed supports them in building their wealth and securing their long-term financial independence. I don't think it does necessarily mean women advisors or special women-focused products, but certainly it does mean an approach that makes women feel just better with financial planning by being practical, intuitively understandable, without the frequent financial jargon that financial professionals always fall into. All of that, we think, is just participating to support women in making money work harder for them.
So there are several different options there which you're alluding to, Nannette. Some banks go for the generic advice for women, others for a more life cycle investing approach. Which route works best in your opinion?
Now, we think at Credit Suisse that investing through the life cycle stages of women hopefully will help investment advisors actually engage more successfully with their female clients and help them establish a long-term relation that is founded on trust, on deep understanding, on openness. I mean, what better way to open the conversation just by focusing on the life cycle stage in which women are? I mean, after all, women do adapt their own lives, how they set themselves up, what they do in those different stages of their lives, with the new needs, the new constraints that are coming with them. And in the same way, we think a portfolio of investments has to take those needs and constraints into account as well and mirror the life cycle stage where they're in. For example, by adjusting a portfolio's asset mix when it is time to reduce volatility, to reduce risk exposure, because there is just simply less tolerance to risk in the phase where women have fluctuations in income, for example, or the emphasis on payouts when women need a source of added cash flow. All of that, we think, is very practical and can help women make their money work harder for them along their whole life so that they can build wealth and build financial independence and in time eliminate the gender investment gap.
So would you say, Nannette, that there are particular themes or indeed super trends that are particularly suited to women clients?
Yes, this is really an important point. We think that for women, feeling connected to their investments actually can play a critical factor in nurturing their interest and more comfort with securities, with the understanding of financial instruments, and also to steer a more responsible investment activity. Especially in equities, where women sometimes have a little bit of apprehension because of the risk they perceive, super trends are a very intuitive way, you could argue an entrepreneurial way, to invest in equities, because it builds on societal trends that women see in the world around them every day. And they understand how this can create both business opportunity, but also, importantly, investment opportunity.
Now, Marisa, you are known in the wealth management world for your passion for environmental and social issues. How can portfolio managers help their clients have a stronger connection with their investments?
Absolutely. Well, first, I always say it starts with asking your clients what are the things that they care about. What are those areas where they would like to drive change with their capital? What are those places where, if you were creating a better world for yourself, you'd like to see the change happening? And that is the first step to what we call values alignment with your investing. So as people increasingly are trying to say, I want my capital to deliver outcomes, if you start with that very fundamental question, oftentimes, what does the family stand for? Is it education? Is it healthcare? Do you care deeply about oceans? If you can express that, then portfolio managers can work with you to try to define those investments that speak to your needs. And I think that really then gets to that linkage in a very, very, I'd say, visceral and emotive way. And we find that that is a very productive way to have a deep conversation on this topic.
And when we're looking at these themes, which you mentioned, healthcare, oceans, alleviating poverty, perhaps, from what we've seen, it appears women in particular are taking the initiative to embrace these themes, to make their investments more sustainable and resilient, and prioritising these environmental, social and governance factors in their portfolios. Does being a woman actually make a psychological difference when it comes to making these key investment decisions?
Well, certainly I hate to overgeneralize, but one of the things that we see when we poll our female population of clients is that they have a higher propensity at the outset to want to make impact investments. And I think what's maybe underpinning that to some degree is that most women still have the primary burden of caregiving. They are very deeply connected to trying to create that better world for their children. And when they hear their children articulate the fact that they do not like the world they're inheriting, I think it's a uniquely female desire then to respond and say, if I have a power with my capital to drive that change and create that better legacy for my children, then I want to do that. So I think all of these things are very uniquely feminine in some respects.
So if we look at how to position clients to, and the bankers to, anticipate key investment themes, risks and challenges, is there anything else women can do to be better prepared for the future investment climate?
Well, certainly I say start with asking yourselves, what is it that you care about? What change are you trying to drive? What outcomes would you like to see? If you are motivated by trying to deliver a better world for your children, what are those key aspects that bother your children? Those are places that allow you to get stuck into things that I think you will then find an emotional connection with. And there I would also say, when you do that, make sure that you are well-informed. I would access as much as you can in terms of information so that you're making good informed decisions. Because I think oftentimes we are very susceptible to little sound bites that might be out there in the media, and we might pile into something without really understanding the totality of the consequences of where that capital is going. And the final thing is diversification. One of the things that we do find, if I were to generalize, is that women tend to identify with hard assets in their minds as being the safest. So things like real estate, or whenever you see a bit of market disruption, they move into cash. But if you're putting all of your eggs, so to speak, into one or two baskets, two things happen. One is that you create undue risk for yourself if there is a market disruption. And there are going to be market cycles in every industry and every sector. But secondly, you will also miss opportunities. The other thing that I tend to think that women equate when they're thinking about investment funds is that they equate liquidity to safety. And sometimes they then miss opportunities in the illiquid end or alternatives end of the spectrum, where on a risk adjusted return basis, there's enormous potential to create long-term returns over a defined period of time. So if we think about private equity as a perfect example, those are 10-year time horizons typically, but the types of returns associated with that 10-year time horizon will be in the double digits and deliver in theory far more robust returns than say in the public equity space.
Well, Nannette Hechler-Fayd'herbe and Marisa Drew, both from Credit Suisse, many thanks for today's discussion.